Right now, I'd like to invite Reverend Patrick Lager to the podium this morning. And brother, I just release you to minister the Word of God and the power and the authority of the Holy Spirit today.
Are you excited?
Amen.
I am. You know, some of the words there on the screen talk about Jehovah Jireh, Jehovah Nissi. You know, some of the in the scriptures they call it the names of God. And something I learned was that those names were given to him by people. They saw God move. They saw him do something. And all of a sudden, it's like people, just like you and I, they said, "Oh, I'm going to sacrifice my son." And you came and you prepared another sacrifice that I didn't have to lose my son. You are Jehovah Jireh, the God that provides.
That's right.
And Jehovah Nissi was Moses, where he saw everything that God was doing, and he says, "You are Jehovah Nissi. You are the God that covers me."
That's it.
And see, those were people like you and I. And what it is they saw the character of God, that he was a provider, that he was somebody that covered. Moses again said, "You are the God that healeth me." Yeah. Jehovah Rapha. But there was a time when a man asked God, "Who are you?" And God says, "I am that I am."
Amen.
And the fact is that today when we come here to worship him, is that if Jesus never stepped down onto this earth, that God was still worthy of your praise.
Amen. Right.
He was still the God of all glory.
Hallelujah.
He was still clothed in holiness.
Yeah.
He still measured the earth and the universe with the span.
That's right.
How much more now that we can sit here and come into his presence because of the blood of his son.
Amen.
So when we worship today, I want us to get a little bit deeper than just the outer courts.
Come on.
I want us to come into his presence and just give him all the glory and all the honor for everything he has done. Not just because he was a God that just sat up there and was still holy, was still worthy, but because he came and he met us right where we were at.
Amen.
So I feel so humbled to be here. I appreciate the invitation. Truly, the invitation was something of God. I had no clue what this church was, who the pastors were, and God orchestrated everything. So he's done it all, so we're going to let him do the rest of it too. So if you've got your Bibles, let's go to Psalms 32. The worship team, the first song already had part of this verse, and we don't combine on stuff like that. The Spirit of God is already here, and we're just going to let him move in absolutely positively any way he wants to move. When you're there, just shout out an amen to me.
Amen.
Is this a Presbyterian church? Did I take it? Okay, hold on.
They just ain't got there yet.
I got a little lost coming here, so I didn't know if I just really messed up and went in the wrong parking lot. All right. Give me an amen.
Amen.
All right. We're at the right church. All right. Well, let's pray before we go into the Word. Father God, we give you the glory. We give you the honor. Your name be lifted up and exalted, Lord Jesus. The Word of God says, "Lift up your head, O ye gates, and let the King of glory come in."
Amen.
Be lifted up, O ancient doors. Let the King of glory come in. Father God, you are King, and we proclaim you as King here. Lord Jesus, come forth in the glory, in the robes of righteousness that are pure white, that you have gotten because you are the Son of God. But also, Father God, you have come today with garments for us that we may be holy even as you are holy.
Yes.
Father God, I give this word unto you. It is your word. It is your glory. Father God, I ask for an unction and an utterance of the Spirit, and I will not hesitate to give you all the glory. Move on these hearts, Father God, that they may see you and the power and the glory of your redemption. And the people of God said amen and amen.
Amen.
All right. You. Psalms 32 verse 7 says, "Thou art my hiding place. Thou shalt preserve me from trouble. thou shalt compass me about with the songs of deliverance.
Yes.
Now this verse has a lot of significance to me. It's a very powerful verse. It was a verse that met me in a very, very dark place. I started doing drugs at a very young age. I think it was right at sixth grade, so whatever that is, 12 or 13 years old, I started getting into drugs. I was actually born in South America, in Brazil, and the culture there is it's a drinking culture. So I literally remember as a 3, 4, 5-year-old walking by, and my uncle has a glass of beer, and he would just hand it to me. And I would drink freely, so that was just a part of my life. Generations and generations and generations and generations of my family, that's all we did. My grandfather on my dad's side was an alcoholic. He owned a bar. He was known and renowned for drinking. Obviously, my last name is Lager, so that doesn't really help. You know? So I guess I was just destined for that. And who knows that when we come into this world, we are destined for death. There's a very scary statistic that 1 out of 1 people die.
That's right.
It's coming. It's coming. But the pollution of sin increases that. Increases that. So let's just get right into it. I started doing drugs then, and as I started doing drugs, I started craving it. I started wanting it. I started desiring it. I wanted it every single day. So at the beginning of high school, you know, I started saying, well, if this drug does this, what would this do? So about my, you know, sophomore year of high school, I started experimenting with LSD, with ecstasy, and prescription pills. And the whole time when I woke up, all I wanted to do was get high. I started to become that. That's who I was. And what you don't realize sometimes when you are in sin is what the Bible says, that you literally become sin.
Right.
You become a slave to sin, where sin is your master. And I was one of those where I didn't grow up in church. You know, I did the communion, confirmation as a young child, but then we went to church when? Easter and Christmas. Because if you don't go those days, something's wrong. So that's what we would do. We would just go on those special holy days. But then I would leave, and I would live my life contrary to God. And when you start doing that every day, remember, the Bible is straight. Whatsoever a man sows, that shall he reap. So I started to sow seeds of anger, of violence, of sexual immorality. And at the whole time, that spirit of addiction was getting deeper and deeper and deeper embedded into me. I don't know if we have any addicts in the house, but I tried to quit. We know about that, right? We try to quit everything. New Year's, we try to quit eating, kind of, don't we? And at the end, it's like, waiter, give me the pork chop. I want it. Give me the baked potato. Give me everything. And gravy. I want gravy. You know? But that's what we do. We just do that. So I try to quit multiple times. But when you start living that life over and over and over again, and then you get Christians who come up to you, and they would go, Patrick, you're going to go to hell. You're too good of a person to go to hell, you know? But guess what? On Friday night, where were they?
Yeah.
Same place as me. Next to the same keg as me.
Yeah.
They might not have been into the same drugs I was in, but they were living that same life.
Wow.
And they would waste their times on Sunday morning. So I started to despise Christianity. I thought Jesus was a joke. There were times that I was high, that I was stoned, that I was out of control, and I would look up to the sky and I would curse him. And I'd say, you have no power. What kind of a God are you? Where's Jesus? I thought Jesus was a coward. I thought he was for a bunch of Christian people who couldn't really take the reality of life, so they needed a cop out. And that hypocritical Christianity is all I saw. It's all I saw. And it's in the church today. Don't think that faded away a couple years ago. We need to remember that Peter said, the day is coming where judgment shall begin in the house of the Lord. And you start seeing these mega ministries where the people, the men of God, the women of God, fall, and you realize that they've got a rap sheet of a bunch of filthy sin. And it's more about TVs and it's more about money than it is the shed blood from the cross. So I got tired of this back and forth stuff. So I hated God. I hated Jesus. Deep down, I knew there was something. I knew that this, you know, I knew that there couldn't be nothing. And then nothing exploded and created. How can nothing explode? That just didn't make sense to me. So I knew there had to be something more. So, you know, you try the Ouija boards. You try, you know, to enlighten your mind. You try to leave reality out of your mind. And I came up with several very good religions. But every single one was Patrick Annaney.
Yeah.
And that's so much what we see today. In the church or out of the church.
That's right.
We formulate, we pick and choose what we want. And you know what we pick and choose? What makes us feel nice and cozy.
That's right. Come on.
It makes me feel real good. It makes me feel real good to hit that joint and lift up my hands. That's what we do. And we lower God to who? To you and me. We make God out to be us. We conform God to us. Guys, He doesn't need to prove Himself to you today. He's already done it all. He's never changed. So today, don't come to this altar asking God to conform to you. It's time to die today. It's time to die to ourselves and come into the presence of a holy God and then become holy. Become holy like Him. Remember, I know that's Leviticus. And we don't read Leviticus, nor do we even count Leviticus anymore. You know, little rabbit trail, we tell new believers, just start reading that Bible, glory to God. Just got saved and start reading that Bible. They get to Genesis, they're like, oh, this is maybe a little bit familiar. And then they hear Moses and they're like, oh yeah, I've heard of Moses. And then they go to Leviticus. Honey, theologians don't understand Leviticus. Much less somebody new. So we need to tell them to go to the Gospel of John and find out who the Redeemer is. Find out who saved them. All right, back on track. Where was I? I'm just kidding. So we come to this place where we formulate God to us. We want God to be like us. And I said, oh, and you know, I did the whole thing. I didn't believe in God, but I hated God.
Come on.
You know what I mean? Have you ever been there? You know, you completely disregard God, but I'm going to heaven. Because I'm a good person. I'm fantastic. Look at all the things I say about myself. I am a good person. We have a list that we just think we're the best. And it's pride and it's arrogant.
That's right.
And we despise God, but yet we want every single promise that God has for us.
Come on.
So as I'm living this life, you're going to get deeper and deeper and deeper. By my junior year of high school, I met cocaine. It was a terrible friendship. I destroyed him and I hated him and I loved him. And he absolutely destroyed me. He absolutely brought me to nothing. He absolutely crushed my heart. He absolutely destroyed my body. I couldn't let go. I was one of those where we would start doing cocaine at 7, 8 o'clock at night. We'd have to get several more 8 balls in the middle of the night. And 10 o'clock in the morning, we're doing our last line. And we're getting a bottle of liquor just to come down so I can go to class and go to a baseball game. That's who I was. So that was my life every single day. When you're out in college, somehow I made it to college. Don't ask me how. Because every authority in my high school, I went to a high school in Orlando, Florida. And we had 6,000 kids in the high school. And we had about 1,200, 1,300 in my graduating class. Every time I came to school, the officers were sitting there waiting for me. They were looking at me. They were waiting for me to slip up. And I was arrogant. I was prideful. I was a fool. And I challenged every bit of authority. I hated authority. Because why? When you're in that drug state and in that alcohol state, everybody's against you. Everybody's after you. I got arrested. And the judge says, you have broken the law. And I was just like, how dare he say that? How dare he say I broke the law? What's the law? See, I was a fool. Did I not break the law? Yes. There was times where I hurt people. Where I got into a group of friends that we went out and we were a pack of wolves. We just went out and all we wanted to do was fight. That's all we wanted to do. It'd be a Friday night and it'd be Patrick's night. And we'd go out, and I'd be drinking, I'd be doing cocaine. Heaven forbid I was doing acid too. But I would walk around and I'd be looking at you. And I caught one bad eye and I said, "What you looking at?" And next thing you know, it's a bloodbath. But see, that rage was so deep into me, and it came, and it stemmed from pride, because I was the toughest person at any place, at any time, in here, in here. I remember my dad. My dad said, "Son, I want you to get out of that, because one day you're going to meet your match." "Oh, come on, Dad. Come on. You should see me. You should see me. I never met him. Praise God." I've been decked before. I mean, not even looking, and somebody just walked up and boom, and that hurt. Man, I'm glad I didn't meet the one who could finish me. But that was my life. That was the circle of my life. And I'm not going to be graphic, but sexual immorality raged in my life, all my life. I was filled with sin. I was a servant of sin. I was a slave of sin. I was an enemy of God. I was an adulterer. I was a cast down sinner. And I loved it. And I prided my life off of it. There was nothing you could say with your gospel. People didn't talk to me. The strong Christians, they didn't want to talk to me. Because I was somebody where they considered, there's nothing I can say. He's not going to change. Do you hear me? Christians,
yeah.
He's not going to change.
Yeah.
Do they know Jesus? Do they know this gospel that was written in blood? Obviously they didn't. Through all that time, somehow, and I'm telling you, it's by the grace of God, I went to Baltimore, Maryland from Orlando, Florida with a scholarship to go play college baseball. I threw up one of my flags. I said, "Man, I'm going to quit. I'm going to try my best. I'm going to go to Baltimore, a brand new person. Nobody knows me."
Wow.
You know? When nobody knows you, who knows? It's easy to fake.
Yeah.
It's easy to lie. You know, you can say whatever you want. You can say, I'm a king from Israel. You can say whatever you want. So then I show up there. And I remember I was in a two-bedroom apartment with four baseball players. And I walked in and one of the guys said, "You smoke pot?" And I went, "Maybe. What you got?" He goes, "Well, your roommate's got a QP. You like to drink? Maybe. What you got?" He said, "Got a fridge full of beer. Raise your hand if you thought I quit." I didn't. Went right back in there. The terrible thing was that the roommate who was in my room, he was a coke fiend from Dayton, Ohio, from Kettering. So guess what? Him and I hooked up. And the first thing you got to do when you're on a tight budget, and I don't know if you know, but cocaine ain't cheap. First thing you got to do is you got to do something nice to the drug dealer. You got to have him over. You got to have a party. Because when you get him partying, he brings out his stuff. So we made good friends with the dealer. And so there it was. We were coke fiends. And then at the same time, I'm playing college baseball. You know, which is a stressor in itself. You know, the toll on your body is hard. So I was living this life. I mean, we would be at parties at my house, and we'd go out and box in the middle of the night. I'd wake up in the morning, my ankle is swole like this, and my eye is hurting. Like, I go, "What happened last night?" They're like, "Oh man, you were boxing good last night." And I said, "Well, I sure don't feel it right now. I sure don't feel it." So my body, I was putting my body through everything. I was killing myself. But every single morning, I would wake up and I'd say, I need to drink. I was living off mayonnaise sandwiches, but I was stocked full of liquor and beer. My parents would give me money every week. I'd get a loaf of bread, I'd get a jar of mayonnaise, and that's what I'd eat every morning. And then the little ramen noodle cups. Man, those get tiring after a couple months. And that's all I would do. But I would stay high. I would stay drunk every single day. I would go to school drunk. I'd wake up in the morning and drink close to a 12-pack. Every single morning, I'd get up, and that is exactly what I do. And that was my entire life. My whole life was surrounded around that. I became sin, and I hated God. I despised God. I despised the gospel, the thought of the gospel, the notion of the gospel of Jesus Christ. My second year in college, I met a family. And they invited me over. And they started talking about Jesus. You know, my first thought was, heard about him. But this is what I call, they knew the real Jesus.
Amen.
It wasn't a cross on their little neck. It wasn't a little t-shirt with thorns and nails. It wasn't a little poster on the wall. It was the one who rose again.
Yes.
And guess what? They saw that spirit of addiction in me. They saw all the devils around me. And they weren't one bit scared of who I was. They weren't afraid of all my fights. They weren't afraid of my cursing. They said, come on in. Come on in. Greater is he that is within me than he that is in the world. Come on in. And I started to see the real Jesus. And let me tell you this. For you to know how to lead people to the Lord, you know what they started telling me? They didn't tell me about their holy garments. They said, man, we used to do drugs too. What? You're Christians. Christians don't do that. Yeah, man, we did drugs for years while married with a child. What? You guys are fake as everybody else. So what happened? God delivered us. Never heard that before. And then all of a sudden, it's like our marriage was on the rocks. I said, what? Divorce? Drugs? Are you sure you're serving Jesus? They went to a meeting. Both of them were unsaved. They went to a meeting. Didn't even sit together. Went to a Christian concert. Both of them gave their hearts to the Lord that night. When they came home, they said, I've got to talk to you about something. And the other one was like, well, I've got to talk to you about something too. And both of them thought they were going to say divorce. Well, what happened? At that concert, I gave my life to Jesus. I did too. And all of a sudden, the gospel transformed their life. So they started feeding that to me. And who knows, when you're a broke down drug addict, filled with rage, filled with sexual immorality, when somebody tells you about something good, you know, we preach hell. And don't get me wrong, there's hell. We need to preach hell. But Romans 2:4 said it is the goodness of God that leads to repentance. I needed something good in my life. I would wake up, my body was torn to pieces. Was torn to pieces. I was a good baseball player. I 96 mile per hour fastball, I hit it. So my thoughts was pro baseball, pro baseball. My life was death. 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 So I chased death with an aspiring of baseball. By the end of the season, my right knee was torn to shreds, or my left knee was torn to shreds. Meniscus was practically gone. So I had to have knee surgery. Well, guess what? Baseball's cutthroat. They don't care about you. Oh, you're injured? We'll keep track of you. All of a sudden, pro baseball was just this lost thought. Well, I had to have knee surgery. And I told the doctor, I said, the scout from the Braves said, I need a note from your surgeon exactly how the surgery went, what he sees the recuperation is, and will ever you use a brace. I practically brought a gun to that meeting and said, you better write some good stuff, doc. And you better sign it. But there it was. I didn't really look for other schools to go to because my desire was to play pro baseball. But remember, my lifestyle was dead. I'd wake up in the morning and I had a hurt knee. There was times in the middle of parties, I was drinking, I was raging, I was talking trash, I was getting drunk, getting high, that I'd go up to my bedroom because my knee was just, I could barely go up the stairs, and I had to ice my knee in the middle of a party because my body was being destroyed. When you live that lifestyle, you don't know what you're doing. You wake up, you don't know where you've been. There's times where I woke up, I had a stick shift car, and I would wake up and I'm sitting at a stop sign in a neighborhood like a mile from my house. And in a stick shift, if you put it in neutral and let go of the clutch, the car stays on. You know, if you leave it in first gear, you know what I'm talking about, and you lift a club to you. No. But there I sat, woke up, 7 o'clock in the morning, just woke up. Sitting at a stop sign. Whatever it was, I don't know how I got there. I just pulled up, I put it in neutral, and passed out. And I'll tell you what, God wasn't behind that. God didn't put me behind that wheel. God didn't want me to do drugs. God doesn't want you to do drugs so he can have a testimony. He don't need drugs to give you a testimony. Because whether you grow up in church your whole life and never sin, because you know we categorize sin. The drug addict, that's sin. But gossiping about everybody else, that's not sin. That's church. But God doesn't need that. You have a testimony. If you've been in church your whole life, at some point you still needed the blood.
Amen.
You still needed the cross.
Yes, sir.
But I was there, bound up. No one could set me free. This one family would talk to me, and they would talk about his faithfulness. They would talk about it's the goodness of God. And I needed something good in my life. I needed something good.
Yes.
So I remember I said, I'll try it. I'll give my heart to the Lord. And it wasn't some huge religious ceremony. I didn't do it in front of people. I didn't go to church and confess it before everybody. I didn't run and get baptized. I didn't jump in the water. I just thought it in my mind. I said, Jesus, the way these people talk, there's got to be something about you. And here's where I am. It ain't much, but can you help me? And I remember I finally wrote a couple letters to colleges. We went to the World Series of Junior College, and my knee was so hurt that my hip messed up because I was favoring my right leg so much that I got a stress fracture on the neck of my femur. Side note, do not get a stress fracture on the neck of your femur. It hurts. So the last game of the World Series, I couldn't even play. I sat there and had to cheer my teammates. The coach from Morehead State University came to watch me play. What's going on with Lager? Well, he's hurt. He can't play today. Now God had really blessed me that season. I was a first-team All-American. I got all the accolades. Everything that the world says is great, I got. So I want you to know that even if the world says you're doing great, Patrick's going to college. Patrick's got an associate's degree. He's a first-team All-American. He's going to play baseball someday. He's going to be a professional. I was dead in my sins. Everything on the outside looked really good. My friends were saying, Patrick, you are proof that we can make it. What do you think we was? The drug addict, the alcoholic, the one filled with sin and anger and bitterness and violence. That's who we were. This family in Baltimore got me around the table. And I didn't know what was going on. I didn't know what laying on of hands. I thought they were going to choke me out. I didn't know. I thought they were going to do a deliverance service. I didn't know what was going on. I just sat down and peripheral. And they just came and they just laid their hands on me and they said, we proclaim the blessings of the Lord Jesus Christ over you.
Amen. Yeah.
And you know, I just felt loved. I felt at peace.
Yeah.
Now from that right there, I came to Morehead State. Who thinks I got delivered? I didn't. Came to Morehead. Praise God. I walked into one of the things they prayed was, Father, bless him with a good roommate. Because Lord knows the last one didn't work out. Bless him with a good roommate. Walk in, and I go from a three-story townhouse to a Morehead jail cell. Two beds. My arm wire was here, and that was it. A desk, and that was it. So I walk in, and on my roommate's fridge, there's a teen study Bible about that thick, and just shred to pieces. And I'm going to be honest. I despised God. I lived a life of sin. But these people who were real, they prayed, and all of a sudden, Jesus heard it. You see what I'm saying? You see, from my standpoint, honey, I was almost in tears. I ran, grabbed the cell phone. I didn't even meet my roommate yet. He could have come in with a turban. I want to know. I called those people. I said, guys, he's got a Bible, and it's huge. It's tore up. I mean, and I don't mean cut. I mean, like, it's red. Oh, Patrick, praise the Lord, I went. Praise the Lord. So this is my second shot. Round two. Nobody knows me. And what did I hate more than anything? Hypocrites. Grew up my whole life. with Christian hypocrites. Got two mouths and two faces, and both of them I don't like. I said, Patrick Lager is going to say and profess that he's a born-again Christian. And I didn't know any better. I said, hey, Patrick Lager, I'm a Christian. Christian. Baseball team. Who knows? Usually baseball teams aren't filled with the love of God. Okay? You know, no offense to the baseball players in the house. But it's just not something. You know, college athletics isn't just really something that you just, you know, the Tim Tebows aren't common. They're just not. So there I was. They think I'm a prude. You know, and in my mind, I'm going, honey, you better be glad I'm saved. Because if I wasn't saved, I'd knock you out. Okay? I'd knock you out. I would absolutely knock you out. And I would. I'm not being serious. I think I told one of them that. I can't remember. I think I told them that. I said, man, I'm glad I'm saved, or else I'd knock your teeth out. But that's who I was. So what I did is at Moorhead State, I went to every single Christian organization. Honey, if it had a door and a cross, I was going in. I was going in. Because I had to surround myself with my roommate, born again, his whole life, spirit-filled. Love the Lord, love to worship. We'd go to meetings, and I'd be sitting there, because I'm new to all this. I'm new to the Christian life. And during worship, he would be going, and I'd be like, I'm not getting something. He's getting something. I'm not. And then we had this one worship leader at the Baptist Student Union. It's called something different now at Warren State. But he would always play one last chorus. You know those? I feel God really moving. Let's sing that again. And I'd be like, do we really need to sing that one more time? And then after that, it's, Spirit of God's still here. And I'm like, man, what are you talking about? The song needs to end. And then I look at my roommate. What's my roommate doing? Oh, man, he's loving it. So at some point I said, man, there's something missing. I'm not getting it. So then I started to get into my Bible. I started to read the Bible for the first time in my life. I had a small experience with Christ, maybe in eighth grade, short-lived. People were fake, you know. We look at man. We don't look at God. We look at God. And the Bible says you shall know them by their fruit. But that's to judge their works. That shouldn't be to justify my faith. I have to have faith in Christ regardless of what every other person in here is doing. I have to have that. He came and died and bled for me. For me. So everything was going on. And guess what? Who knows? We in college we have what? We have semesters. Yeah. In baseball we have, you know, seasons. So the fall season was over, the semester was over. Guess where I had to go? Orlando, back home. So, to my surprise, nobody else had gotten saved. The boys were still the boys, the crew. But see, I love the crew. I love the crew. They would die for me. We've been in Brazil. I looked at guns in the middle of fights. People pull out guns. I've seen bottles get cracked on people's heads and 5.5-inch gashes. I've seen it. But if that happened to me, they would be behind me. So I'm a Christian, but I've got to be with them. Well, guess what? I was the same old devil. And that's hard to say when you're a Christian and you look in the mirror and you say, I'm still living like a devil. So I would go back to Orlando, Florida, and I'd be the same person I always was. But this time, I would talk about Christianity. And when you're talking about Christianity with a bunch of people who are doing drugs, and you're doing drugs with them, you know something, you look stupid. But see, something happened to me. I couldn't deny that. Even though I still had this life, there was something that happened that was real. And I couldn't deny that. So I lived this life. I became the hypocrite. I became who I despised. I became the person why I hated Christianity. Wow. So I go back to Moorhead. Guess what? We're in revival at Moorhead. January 28th, 2004, I got baptized with the Holy Spirit. Didn't know anything about it. Sometimes I praise God I wasn't raised in church, but I wasn't indoctrinated to the core and let everything else steal God from me. So I got baptized with the Holy Spirit. Immediately, I'm telling you what, something happened. I felt called to ministry. I started to hear from Jesus. I'd be speaking in tongues all the time. I mean all the time. I'd be walking to class, and all you would see, I was a chattering mess. Like what Isaiah said, with stammering lips and with another tongue shall I speak into this generation.
Yeah.
Whole time, I was on fire. All of a sudden, I'd be praying with people. We'd be in prayer groups. And all of a sudden, you know, I go, I just really see this. I see the Lord doing this in your life. And they're like, man, that's awesome. I read this book and it said something similar. And I didn't even know what was happening. And then all of a sudden, we'd be all together and we'd be praying. And I said, hallelujah, you know, this says the Lord. And I would start speaking. I would start prophesying. And in my head, I'd go, what did you just say? Because I just started reading the Bible. And I started learning about false prophets. Okay? Stones. Death. Okay? Go prophesy naked for a couple of years, Isaiah. You know, I didn't want anything to do with that. I called up the family in Baltimore in tears, crying, scared. I said, this is what's going on. I don't know what's happening. And they just said, oh, praise the Lord. And I'm like, praise the Lord. And cast the demon out of me. I need help from you. Not that. Praise the Lord. He don't say, oh, praise the Lord, son. And he says, I'm excited that the prophetic has been opened to you. And he says, what you feel in fear, keep it. Because the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge.
Amen.
I got baptized with the Holy Ghost, started to speak, started to minister, lay hands, started seeing healings, miracles, revival at Moorhead State in the Baptist Student Union. Mm-hmm. After worship, we'd go in the prayer rooms and honey, we'd have prayer. I was in prayer meetings where one other guy and I were praying and there was 10, 15 people. We're praying. Next thing you know, you turn around, everybody else is on the floor. Everybody's on the floor, getting slain, getting baptized with the Holy Spirit, receiving prayer language, generational curses being broken, everything, strongholds being destroyed. Baseball season ended, and guess what? I'm ready now. I've got the fire of the Spirit of the living God. I'm speaking in tongues. I'm dancing before the Lord. I'm ready to go to Orlando. Who thinks I quit? Every day. I went back, drank every day, drugs every single day. How could I do that? The Spirit of God was in me. I'd be in circles of people doing drugs, and I would sit there and have prophetic words for every single person in the circle. And I'd sit there going, what am I doing? When the joint came around, I'd still hit it. Got invited to preach at a youth group, minister at a youth event. I got stoned that day and went and ministered. And I started talking about the Jesus that I knew. The Jesus that is the God that delivers you. Jehovah said to Cain, the God our righteousness. And the Holy Spirit sat there and said, you're lying to them because you haven't let me take. So then all of a sudden, you know, I've got a life of violence and of anger and of instability and all the drugs and all the drinking and the wild times of my life, you know, all of a sudden suicide just started coming into my head. And I'd walk by my dad's closet, and on the top left of the closet's where he kept his gun, and had two clips and bullets were in it. And I would start contemplating, you know. You know what I mean? I don't know if any of you have been there, but you start going, you know, would anybody care? You know, what would happen? You know, would anybody even come to the funeral? You know, what would happen? I don't know. I'd walk off and I would be doing drugs and I'd be drinking, and that thought, I'd get there and I'd be depressed. I'd sit on my bed and I would hear the devil talk and says, you are a liar. You have absolutely no hope. You have no power. I am still in power. Death has come to you. You need to end your life because you failed God, and He will never take you back. And I would sit there, and honestly, everything he said was right. I did fail God. I don't think He'll ever take me back. And I sat there. And I sat there every day. I would contemplate suicide. I would think of it in my mind. And I would still do the drugs, even though I knew they would kill me. I would still pick up the Bible, the drink, knowing that it would kill me. It would be the end of me. Every single day. That year, Hurricane Charlie came and hit Punta Gorda in Florida, and then hit Orlando. And I remember we were out without power for a week in Orlando, Florida in August. It was a hot mess. I was a hot mess. And one day I found myself on the bedroom floor, 8900 Laurel Lane, Orlando, Florida, 32817. And I sat there. I don't know where my parents were. And I was on the carpet. My knees were almost red and bloodied because I'd been there, and I started begging. I didn't know what I was doing. I said, I need something. I need this. I can't go on any longer. And the enemy's sitting there saying, you need to kill yourself. You need to end your life. You have no power. You failed. You need to go get the gun. And I saw a picture of the gun in the closet. It was in a green, like a beanie or a toboggan, whatever you call it. It was green. Inside had a red stripe. And the gun was there with two clips. And I knew where it was. I knew how to do it. I knew how to put the bullet in the chamber. And I finally said in my mind, I said, that I can't do this anymore. I can't live this two lives. I can't do it any longer. I need to end it right now. And then God came. The devil will always talk more than God, because God only needs one word. And guess what God said? Psalms 32:7.
Yes.
Said, thou, O Lord, art my hiding place. I shall keep you from trouble. I shall compass you with songs of deliverance.
Yes.
And you know what he said? He said, son. Firstly, he called me son. Drugs in my system. Alcohol still on my breath, and he called me son. He saw the covenant that I had made with him and the covenant that I had broken. Even though I didn't live it, he saw the covenant that I chose to believe in. And he called me his son. And he said, I'll take you right now, right where you're at. He didn't say, go down to the street to the church. He didn't say, call a pastor. He didn't say, call my friends. He didn't say, call all your Christian buddies and your roommates. He said, I'll take you right now, right where you're at.
Yes.
Right there, something broke inside of me, because quitting is all about you and it's all about me.
Yeah.
But deliverance has to come from God.
Yes.
It has to come from Him, and He's the only way. Listen to this definition. To compass, remember the verse, thou art my hiding place, thou shalt preserve me from trouble, thou shalt compass me about with songs of deliverance. In the Hebrew, it's to go around, surround, encircle, engulf, to change direction, to be surrounded, to change, surround, shield, to go about, to turn about, circle around, to be set, to be mounted. Even in that state, the Lord says, I will circle you. I will mount you to be on top. I'll change your direction. Every step, I'll go with you. Deliverance means to deliver or escape. You hear what I'm saying? So it's not only that He'll encircle you in your time of need, in your time of addiction, in your time of alcohol, rage, adultery, sexual immorality, whatever sin you got, He'll encircle you. And then it says He'll escape, which means that if you escape and He's circling you, that means every step you go, He'll circle around you. He'll be set around you. He'll mount on top of you. Every single step you take. And songs of deliverance. Songs, literally there's a parenthesis and it says joyful songs. It was a time of joy, because the one who had chains has now been set free. Guess what? 10 years ago is when that happened. I've never touched drugs since. I've never touched alcohol since. Because God came and brought me from that place. He met me where I was at. He came and brought me from that place. He's still the same. I had to separate myself from my friends. He says, as a dog returns to its vomit, so the fool to his folly. And I would look at sins of pornography and sexual immorality and drugs and drinking, and I would see myself vomiting and picking it up and eating it. That's gross. I know, so is sin. I couldn't be the same anymore. He broke it inside of me. He destroyed the strong man. He bound the attacks of the enemy. Did the enemy come back? Of course he does. When Jesus was tempted, it says, and the devil retreated for a season. He's always going to come back. But see, then all of a sudden the word started to take root in me. That God will never put me in a position that will overtake me. That in any situation, he'll always give the place to repent and to walk away from the temptation. And there I was. I was a new man. Everything was new. I started to walk my calling. I went back to Moorhead. I'll never forget. I had met this girl named Kimberly a year before. And I was sweet on her. And so I came back, and she was just one of a good friends that just loved Jesus. Grew up spirit-filled her whole life. Started speaking in tongues at 5 years old. If you don't think that can happen, go ask my son, because he can. He has his own prayer language, and it don't sound like mine. The Spirit of God loves your children more than you do. And he wants them to be filled with the utterance of the Holy Ghost more than you do. So just let them. If they're just going to play around and mumble it, let it go. Because one day the Spirit of God's going to step in and they're going to have a real language. But that's what it's about. That's what everything is about. So I got sweet on this girl. And I'll never forget. I got back into town. I called her, got back to Moorhead. And she asked the question, how's your summer? And I went, I said, now would be a perfect time to lie. You know, what do Christians do? How's your day? Great. And really inside you're going, ah! We're Pentecostal, we can shout.
Right.
Come on.
Right.
This is Pentecostal, right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. All right, I can go on the message. No, I'm just kidding. How's your summer? And for some reason, something broke in me that I couldn't be the same person I used to be. And I said it was terrible. Mm-hmm. I backslid the entire summer. And I almost went, didn't know if she was going to slap me or condemn me. She goes, but are you right now? Did you repent and come back to God? And I said, I did. End up, about 2 months later, I started dating her. Started dating her October 30th, engaged to her January 17th, married August 5th. And then all of a sudden, but what was beautiful is I have never been bound in addiction when I've been with her. See, that's the God that encircles you.
Amen.
He mounts you. He sets on top, and he walks with you on the escape of deliverance. And it's a joyful song. I love it when it says, and it's marvelous in his sight.
Yes.
Jesus Christ set me free. I never want to touch a drug again, and I never will. Not in pride, but in humility. In humble, because I know what he has done. I'm about to close, but let me share you a vision I had a couple of years after I got saved. I had this vision. And it was Jesus standing at the scourging post. God still gives visions.
Yes,
he still gives dreams.
Yes,
and I saw this vision, and I was taken back because I saw Jesus on the scourging post. And I saw the devil with the cat of nine tails. I saw the bones in it. I saw the mirrors of glass in it. I saw the balls of steel that they used to whip him. And I sat there. And Jesus was just standing there, and every now and then they would look up like this, and the devil would sit there like this, and he'd look up as well. And I didn't know what was going on. And all of a sudden the devil says, I have come to whip the Son of God because of Patrick Lager. His sins are on these lashes. And the devil reared back And he started whipping the Son of God, and he started calling out my sins. Cocaine. And I saw the blood come out. I saw his skin, the real skin, not the movie The Passion skin, not Hollywood, not makeup and artistry, a real body with real blood. And I saw the body start getting scarred and the drips of blood coming down. And his blood was poured on the first lash according to my sin of addiction. And he started calling out my sins, and every sin was a lash on his body. You see what I'm saying? I saw my sins on him. It was my fault. I chose the drugs. It wasn't just because my dad did drugs. It was because of me. I wanted the drugs. And every lash, the sin, the pornography, everything, the body was being mutilated. And I couldn't take it anymore. In the vision, I bowed down. I started repenting. And all of a sudden, I heard a shout. And Jesus took his arms off the post and said, "Father, I will take all the lashes for him. I'll take every sin." He took all of my sin. He took every lash. Because he loved me. Because of that. And yes, I saw that vision, but I'll tell you what, in the spirit, I know when I started talking about that vision, some of you saw it too, didn't you? You saw what was happening. You saw what was going on. And you started thinking about your sin. Maybe the sin you're battling today. And you thought we could just sweep it under the rug and nothing would happen. But today, God is moving by His Spirit. And He's wanting to purify us and make us holy. He's wanting to make us new. I think it's Psalm 16:11, if you can put it up there. Psalm 16:11. "For in the presence of the Lord there is fullness of joy." Amen. Man, I'm having a bad day. I just don't feel the presence today. That's your fault. And I don't say it's your fault condemning you. I'm saying that let's turn back to God. It's in His presence there's fullness of joy. Mm-hmm. You can be having a bad day, but you still have joy. Nobody can steal your joy. Nobody can take that away from you. Because it's in His presence there's fullness of joy. And fullness is a similar definition almost to compass. It's to cover you with joy. And it's more than the Pentecostal goosebumps. Okay? It's more than just the ooh. Now don't get me wrong, I love the ooh. I love those. But the presence of God is more than that.
Yes.
It's more than that. It is so much more than that. Where are your hearts today? What does God need to do in you today? What has God brought you from? And you're still having trouble separating yourself. The God of deliverance is here.
Yes.
The God of salvation is here.
Yes, He is.
This is the gospel that I give all glory to Him. I have done nothing for the gospel. The gospel stands on itself. I don't have to preach something different. It's not by the wisdom of man that the gospel is presented. It's just that Jesus Christ chose to come and to sacrifice Himself. He was God and He was fully man. And I don't know what the doctrine exactly is, but I believe if Jesus wanted to sin, He could have. Or else He couldn't have conquered it. If it was impossible for Him to sin, then what did He conquer? If it was impossible for me to sin, then I'd be just like God, right? But He came as a human being just like you and me. Except He honored His mother and His father. Except He obeyed His mother and father. And then when it came time, He says, "My Father is in heaven, and I will be about His business."
Amen. Yeah.
And when a woman walked by in lust, in harlotry, He didn't look, but He saw her through the Father, who the Father is pure in all that He does. And when the temptation of sin came, He refused it. And when the devil came, the devil wanted His worship. He says, "If you will worship Me, I'll give you all the kingdom of the earth."
Yeah.
Who knows that God had already promised him that? Old Testament, it was already promised to him. But he didn't have to go through the scourging post then, did he? He didn't have to be nailed to the cross. The devil offered him the easy way out. And he'll always offer you and I the easy way out.
Yeah.
It's okay. God loves you. You can keep doing that. He loves you. He loves you. You know, drinking's tough. It's all through your family. It's hard. It's hard. You know, God will understand. Oh, that we would be set apart for Him.
Yes.
I see an army of ministry here. I see people that they just can't sit in the pews. They have to go and share. And I see pieces of charred up glass that was your life that God is putting back together.
Yes.
And He's wanting you. He's desiring you.
Yeah.
And that's why I'm here. I'm here to stand in agreement with you. If you need to be saved, I want you to come up. If you need to rededicate, I want you to come up. Or if you need me to stand in agreement for whatever you're believing for. I feel in my spirit there's people, I don't know if you're dealing with stuff legally. Judges have said things that there's nothing you can do about it. God can overturn rulings.
Amen.
He can change that.
Yeah.
I knew people facing 60 years in prison. God changed the sentence. Said, "You're only going to serve 4 years," the judge said. Guess what? He only served 10 months. And then he's out been preaching the gospel into prisons everywhere.
Right. No.
Why? Because there's a higher judge.
Yes. Yes.
There's one who stands and he holds the gavel. On the end, the final word is his. And remember, his word are stronger than any attorney's. And remember that Jesus Christ is the advocate. He's not the prosecuting attorney. He's the defense attorney. He's the one that says, "I'll take all the sins, Father. I'll take all the sins. I'll take everything." Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Honey, I come against rejection. I see the brokenness in your heart. And I just feel with all that I am of the Psalms 51. It says, "A broken and a contrite heart I will not despise." I don't know what's going on right now, but there's a brokenness in you. There's hurts in you, and God wants to come and He wants to heal you. There's even maybe rejection from the past. And he wants to heal you. And he wants you to literally look in the mirror and see what he sees. That you're beautiful. That you have a calling of God. That there's an anointing in you. There's a word in you. There's a song in you. There's a compassion in you. And God always moved in compassion. But sometimes you feel like, I'm never at that place. I'm never at that position where I can stretch out. I can't do that. I can't do that. But God's saying, come on out. My daughter. He keeps saying, daughter. Daughter, you're my daughter. Come on out. I'll be with you. I'll heal you. I'll manifest my glory to you. And there's been tears of pain, and he wants to change that to tears of joy. And don't be humiliated by your brokenness. To God, that is praise. So what you have thought has made you retract from the presence of God, of saying, God, I don't want to come in because I'm broken. He's saying, no, you're already in because you're broken. But know this, that the brokenness has gotten you to the place where healing will come. I don't know what's going on, but honey, you give it to the Lord and you start walking in your calling. Right there, the time on the clock, you're still on time, says the Lord. You are still on time. You haven't missed it. The devil keeps saying you've missed the opportunity, you've missed the chance. The devil, Jesus said the devil is a liar and he has lied to you.
Amen.
But God has come in with truth. You are so valuable to the kingdom of God. And honey, you tell that devil that you're valuable. He died for you. And I'm prophesying restoration in your heart. Even in the family areas. Restoration, restoration, restoration. Where you will know and testify of what God has done. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Father, we give you the glory. We give you all the honor. We just worship you. We just praise you, God. We just honor you. We bring you glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thou art my hiding place. Thou shalt preserve me from trouble. Thou shalt compass me. You'll build a mound. You'll surround me. You'll encircle me. You'll engulf me. You'll change my direction. I'll be surrounded by you. I'll do a change of direction. You'll be my shield. You'll go about me. You'll do a turnabout. You'll encircle around me. You'll be set upon me. You'll be mounted upon me so that I can be delivered, so that I can escape from the attacks of the enemy which have bound me, which have set me back from the presence of God. And I'm going to sing a joyful song over your life, because in your presence there is fullness of joy. There's a presence of God right now for healing. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh Father, we give you the glory. Jehovah Rapha, the God that heals. If there's anybody who's never given their hearts to the Lord, I want you to come up. A lot of times I'll do the hand raised, but man, there's a presence now where just step out.
Yeah.
And just don't care what people think. If there's anybody here that wants to be saved, I want you to come up. If there's anybody that has been bound and needs to be set free, the one who can free you is here.
Yes.
And it's not me. The power to deliver is here. If you've been praying for your children, I want you to come up. There's a power for that right now. If your kids are bound in addiction, there's a power to be set free right now. I saw another vision when I was in Baltimore. There was a time where I was drinking the whole night, did drugs the whole night, and I ended up passing out in downtown Baltimore. And Baltimore at that time was the leader of heroin and homicides in the country. And I was sitting there, I passed out, woke up 5 a.m, had no clue where I was, just on some steps. Years later, after I got saved, God took me in a vision back to that place, and I just saw myself laying on these steps. And real quickly, I knew what it was. I went, you still remember that, huh? And all of a sudden, I saw these dark images come and start surrounding me. And they surrounded me in a circle, dark images, demonic spirits. And all of a sudden, it was a circle, and they opened up like a horseshoe. And Satan walked in, and he he looked up and he says, I have come to take his life because he will not serve you. All of a sudden there were flashes of light and all the demons were gone. And the voice of God came and says, no. His mother has prayed for him. And if I let you take him, then I will not be faithful to her. So it's time to pray. It's time to pray for breakthrough for your children. It's time to pray breakthrough for your sons and for your daughters. Because we have a God who hears. And not only that, if I could set your child free, I would be willing, but I am not able. God is willing. And he's able. He's able to break the stronghold. He's able to bind the strong man. He's able to set them free and at the same time set you free. Because sometimes we're down with the conviction that it's our fault. You're ashamed that they're doing drugs. You're ashamed that they're doing all this stuff because you've been in church your whole life and you forget that the Word of God says train them up in the way they should go, and when they get old they will not depart. When they're in the sin, we forget about the Scriptures. But Jesus Christ by the Holy Spirit says, I will remind you of his teachings. I will remind you of his teachings.